are watching West Hartford Community Television.
You're watching West Hartford Community Television.
You're watching West Hartford Community Television.
For the community, by the community.
It's summer. It's that season of the year where there's a lot of movement, a lot of activity, a lot of change, a lot of heat, a lot of warmth, a lot of vibrancy. But what's your spiritual life going to be like this summer? Are you going to keep it hot? Moving? Active and vibrant? Well, don't you touch that remote now. I'll be right back to tell you about my summer spiritual boot camp called the Upper Room Experience. I'll see you in a second.
Get ready to find hope. Get ready to be inspired. Get ready to discover your full potential. Get ready for total success. From the Total Success Coach, Princess Bola Adelani.
This is Princess Bola Adelani, the Total Success Coach, welcoming you to Inspired Success, your monthly dose of inspiration power, the program that equips you with the power and inspiration for total success. That is success at work and in life. Like I said in my opening, it's summer. It's that time of the year, it's that season of the year where it's hustling and it's bustling and, you know, it's activity, it's active, there's movement, there's change. But there is something that I am sensing in the spirit as well, that as it is on earth, so it is in heaven. I'm sensing that in the spirit also there's a lot of movement, there's a lot of change going on. And what that means is that it's time to pray. And this show is all about talking to you about the power and intentionality of prayer, about the need for coming together and being part of a community of praying people this summer to bring in this season, to transition us from this season that we are spiritually to the next season, the next move of God. And I have with me in the studio an amazing, amazing, amazing woman of God. I mean, she has a proven track record of leading communal prayer, of leading change. She is dynamic. She's a published author. She's an artist. She's a corporate trainer. She's a minister and a life coach, and it gives me great, great pleasure to welcome to Inspired Success, Reverend Barbara LaChance. So welcome to Inspired Success, Barbara. It's such an honor having you on the show.
Thank you, Princess Bowler. It's great to be here.
You're welcome. You're welcome. We're going to dive straight into this conversation. Mm-hmm. You know, there's a shift that I'm sensing. I'm sensing a shift. Spiritually, you know, a lot of shaking, a lot of movement. I really feel like the body of Christ is in a major season of transition, mm-hmm. where God is, you know, is going to change the order of things, mm-hmm. where it's not going to be business as usual. And when I look in the scriptures, I find that usually in those times of transition, it's a time when the body came together and prayed. Mm-hmm. Specifically referencing the book of Acts, mm-hmm. Chapter 1, verse 13 to 14, when the church was transitioning from God with us to God in us. Mm-hmm. And we're transitioning now to them being the leaders. You know, Jesus was no longer going to be with them being the leader. They were going to be the leaders. Mm-hmm. And they were also transitioning from women excluded, really, to women included, because mm-hmm. you would find from resurrection when a woman was the one who got the message that the Lord had risen and took it there. Mm-hmm. You'll find in the book of Acts, that Acts 1, 13 and 14, that it specifically mentions the women that were present.
Sure.
And so they were transitioning from that, you know, women excluded to women included. And what they did was just, they came together as a community and mm-hmm. went to the upper room and sought the face of God and mm-hmm. prayed.
Sure.
And, you know, so anytime there's change for me, whether anytime there's transition, prayer, it becomes the catalyst. Mm-hmm. It becomes the vehicle that transports us through the transition to destiny. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, I know the power and the value of prayer. And as a result, I have created a program for the summer, you know, called the Upper Room Experience, mm-hmm. where I'm inviting people from across all kinds of lines to come together and pray. But there have been a couple of challenges that I've been confronted with, which I want us to talk about, which is something that I've also kind of observed with the body. And one of it is the concept of the inability of the body being able to come together as a whole, unified across, you know, race, gender, you know, ethnicity and socioeconomics. Mm-hmm. And, you know, that's been a challenge for me in this area. And so I want us to talk about that first. What, you know, why, what do you think is responsible for that? Because I'm a corporate trainer, you know, mm-hmm. in my other life. And I, one of the subjects I train for in corporate America is diversity and inclusion.
Sure.
It's such a huge concept now. They mm-hmm. they know the value, they know the business sense of diversity mm-hmm. and inclusion, you know. But yet it seems like the church is always behind the curve and the world is ahead of the curve. So talk to me, let's talk to me about why you think that we can't still, you know, really embrace the entire body and make the church community inclusive and be intentional about that.
Mm-hmm. Well, let me first start by saying that there is a move of God.
Yes.
And there is something happening where
yes.
the body of Christ is coming together. And
yes.
so just in the state of Connecticut, for example,
yes.
back in, I think it was January of 2012,
yes.
it was decided that we were going to have 7 nights of worship.
Yes.
And 1 night of worship each month for
yes.
7 months. And it became as a result of a prophetic word that was given. And we decided that a group of people got together, leaders, and said, let's follow through on this and let's see what happens.
Mm-hmm.
So we started meeting in different locations around the state. And we put the word out. And progressively, the meeting started increasing. And there were more churches coming together each month as we went along. One of the biggest meetings we had was at UConn, the University of Connecticut, where
yes.
we probably had about 650 people there, most of them students, though, which
yes.
was very interesting, but a lot of leaders. There were a lot of leaders from all different denominations that were there.
And were there also all different ethnicities? Because I've been to a lot of the meetings that,
there's,
you know, I've been a part of the, you know, Pastors
yeah.
Alliance and different kind of
sure.
meetings. But when I do go to the meetings, to tell you the truth, I feel like a minority, you know. It's still predominantly
yeah.
Caucasian.
Yeah.
You don't find the Hispanic church there. You don't find the African-American church there. So the church is coming together, but I'm not still seeing it so, you know, integrated.
We did meet for the 7 nights of worship.
Yes.
Then on the 8th month,
yes.
we had our final meeting at First Cathedral
yes.
in Bloomfield at
yes.
Archbishop Bailey's.
Yes.
And there we had a very large number. We probably had about 2,500 people come.
Yes.
Very large number of African Americans, Hispanics,
good,
and Caucasian.
Good, good.
So that was the one time
yes.
that we saw all of the streams coming together.
Yes.
And that really is probably one of the biggest issues that we need to pray for, because you're absolutely right.
Okay.
We don't see the African Americans and the Hispanics and the Caucasians all worshiping together on an ongoing basis.
Exactly. And and why do you think so? I mean, and I think that also there's no intentionality. You see, I think, you know, if corporate America has come to the place mm-hmm. where they understand the value, because what we don't know, we don't value.
Mm-hmm.
What we don't value, I say we abuse or misuse.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And so we've, corporate America has come to see some value, whether it's business value, you know, in being intentional about diversity. Why is the church not intentional about inclusiveness and diversity? Why
do you think it's so? It's a very good question, and I don't know that there's a simple answer. I think part of it is the different streams that we come from.
Yes.
You know, a lot of the people who are involved in the charismatic pre-movement have in the charismatic church and the Caucasian church go along with one stream, and the African-American church, they have their own stream of people that they're affiliated with. And they never intermingle. They don't.
And I think it's also a focusing on the minor rather than the major.
Yes.
I think there's so much focus in the church on the minor, on what divides us, on what we don't agree on, rather than focus on the central, which is the cross of Christ.
Yeah.
And just focusing on our agreements. Rather than our disagreements.
So, but let me tell you what happened.
Yes.
In this past June, there was a luncheon at Wellspring Church, and there were a group of leaders present, probably 35 from across the state, and we had a very good representation from the African-American church, and we had a good representation from the, the Hispanic church.
Things are shifting gradually.
Yeah, and I think what happens often is we have to have a central focus.
Yes.
And with that central focus, so what we're planning now are these 40 nights of worship. And it's going to be all over the state of Connecticut, 40 nights consecutively. Each church will take a night in their own region and join with another church in their region and just worship God and do this consecutively for 40 nights.
Yes.
And so right now, we've got practically, I think by tomorrow we'll have all 40 nights filled. And it's starting on September 14th. And of course it's not, I mean, people can come from every church, you know, to whatever church they want to go to. Somebody can go to all 40 nights if they want to. But it's very exciting. And then as a result of this, what's happening now, there's a whole brand new movement that's taking place, and it's called Impact Connecticut. And so people could actually go to the website and they can find all the information about these 40 nights of worship.
That's awesome. So welcome to Inspired Success. If you're just tuning in, by the way, we're talking today about summer, the Upper Room experience, the program that I have. And we're just talking about the power and intentionality of prayer, unity, prayer and change. And my guest is Reverend Barbara LaChance, the founder of Generational Solutions, LLC. So you Google that and learn more about her, an amazing, dynamic woman. And so, yes, good to hear that we're making some progress,
yes.
You know. Mm-hmm. Excuse me, we're making some progress, you know, little bits of progress here. The other challenge that I have been confronted with is the gender inequity. Mm-hmm. You know, where I find that, you know, the leaders, which are predominantly men anyway, find it difficult to understand co-partnership and the gifting of women, the anointing of women into top senior leadership, where they refuse, you know, to embrace that, you know. And, you know, I feel sometimes that a lot of it has to do with, you know, their own personal sense of insecurities, you know, some sense of intimidation, some beliefs that are not in line with scripture about where the place of women are, you know, thinking women are primarily just should be at home and be in Sunday school in church and misunderstanding scripture, misreading, misinterpreting scripture and saying women should be silent, women should not usurp authority, taking things out of context and reading it within the culture of the Middle Eastern culture and the 14th century culture where women didn't have a voice. So, you know, I know there's some things kind of responsible with for that, you know, and I'm coming across a community of women who are really getting very frustrated, you know, feeling that they have more, they have a destiny, they have a call, they have a place, and not feeling that the church He's giving them the platform and the opportunity to express their gifts mm-hmm. and use it for the kingdom of God.
Sure.
And you have been a pace setter, a trailblazer, very admirable what you've done, you know. And so you talk to me about that. Talk to me and other women who are watching this show and thinking, you know what, how do I then break ground, break mm-hmm. through, and come at, you know, with such great opposition, mm-hmm. from the church.
Yeah.
So you tell me, share some principles and share how, you know, one can lead change and pioneer as a woman and be received.
I was told years ago,
yes.
probably 13 years ago, by a colleague of mine. And he said, Barbara, if you want to start working as a leader among men in the church, they're going to have to consider you one of the guys.
Yes.
And consider that a compliment. And so I thought, I don't know that I want to be considered one of the guys.
Mm-mm.
But I understood what he was saying, that they had to gain a respect for me. And
yes.
they had to understand that I wasn't out to usurp them or
yes.
to do. I was only out to fulfill my calling, my role, my destiny
yes.
in the church.
Yes.
Which every woman has a destiny. Every woman has a unique purpose that they need to fulfill. It's a mandate from God. I believe
Absolutely.
That with all my heart.
Absolutely.
And
if
their call is to a role of leadership, then they need to learn how to become leaders.
So how do they do it? How do they break through? Where you're not accepted, where you're not given the opportunity, where you're faced with this stronghold of mindset that excludes you.
Yeah.
And you know you have this thing in you. You're carrying this thing.
Mm-hmm.
So how do you do that? How do you?
Well, for me,
part of
what I did was very painful because I was a forerunner.
Yeah.
You know, and I used to go into the bathroom after the staff meetings on Friday, cry, because I said, God, why am I here? This is, I don't understand, you know, what? And he said, you're there because I want you there. And you'll see. There was a lot that I had to learn as an individual in my calling that God wanted to teach me. And you know how God puts you in those circumstances when there is something happening in your life that you don't like?
Yeah.
But God allows it to happen because he wants you to grow from it and he wants you to learn from it.
Yeah.
So I would say to any woman who's going through any kind of adversity with, if they're coming against prejudice or if they're coming against, that they really need to look at themselves and their relationship with God and saying, God, what is it that you want me to learn about myself in all of this? I think that's number one,
mm-hmm.
because we really want to be totally 100% right with God. If we're going to go battling against something where there's been such a stronghold in the church for thousands of years.
Yes.
You know, in Israel, the men used to pray, thank God I'm not a dog. Thank God I'm not a Gentile. Thank God I'm not a woman.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. So yes. Okay. And then what would be the next thing that you would say?
Well, then I would think that if you have a calling, you know, and there's mm-hmm. something specific that you want to do, then you need to go to your leaders. You need to go to people. You've got to start knocking on doors.
They does keep getting shot at you. What do you then do?
We're going to have to, because you see, this role,
yes.
I'm not the only four. I've been doing this since the 1980s,
yes.
and it's been a struggle. So even the women who are coming up behind me in many of the churches, I did a conference with Pastor Rick McInnes one time, Equally Yoked. And when we went to the church, he spoke on the Friday evening, and he mentioned that he wasn't going to be there the next day, and that I was going to be speaking, and another woman, Mandy Adendorf, was going to be speaking. The Friday evening, there were a lot of men there. The next day, when I was speaking, when Mandy spoke, there was no men. There was only a small handful of women.
So what do you do?
We have to just continue persevering.
Persevere and keep praying.
We have to keep praying and persevering. And,
and what I would say for me is that you create your own path. You know, I would say Jesus said, look, you know what? If you're not received somewhere, shake the dust
mm-hmm.
and move on. And go where you're received. There's somebody that's, who needs what you're carrying. And so if the church doesn't want to accept it, that means maybe it's not for the church. Maybe it's for somebody else.
Well, people think that ministry always takes place in the context of the church.
Exactly.
But that's not true.
Exactly.
Ministry happens 7 days a week in every outside of the church. And
absolutely.
You can be a powerful woman in ministry outside of the church and probably be even more powerful than you could be inside of the church.
Yeah, but then, you know, the reason why, you know, I go back to the church is that the gift is for the church. The Bible says in Ephesians that he gave them gifts for the work of the spirit ministry,
right,
so that the body will come to the fullness. So, but when you want to use that gift in the church to help the church, to develop the church, the fivefold is for the church. And it's not received, and then you take it out. And like you said, maybe keep praying and keep persevering and all of that.
I knew a businesswoman who one time wanted to work for the church. And she was very productive in leading women's Bible studies, would have 40 or 50 women show up at a Bible study. The church took notice of what she was doing outside of the church,
yes,
and they invited her in,
exactly,
a leadership role.
Exactly.
So we need to use the gifts and talents that
absolutely
we have, but
absolutely
we it might not necessarily be right in the church
absolutely
at this time.
Absolutely.
And build up your confidence in outside of the church, and
yes
then because you are the church.
Yes.
You
absolutely
are the church.
Absolutely.
So that's,
you heard it, sister. You do. We're talking today about unity, about prayer, about change, about the power and intentionality of prayer, of communal prayer. And I have Reverend Barbara LaChance here. And we've just been talking about the challenges about, you know, the church not being cohesive, not embracing women and their gifts. And she's a trailblazer here. And so you've heard it. You have to be persistent. You have to persevere. And then you have to do a heart check and just make sure that some of the resistance you're getting is not something to do with you or something God is trying to teach you, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then I said, you know what? Stop thinking also within the four walls of the church.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we are the church, and let's go out there and make the impact. So if you're not received within the four walls, take it out and go where you're received, where you're celebrated and not tolerated. And, you know, one thing I know about the church is they take notice when there's a proven track record of
success. Absolutely.
You know, they'll embrace you eventually. You can't argue results.
Yeah.
You can't argue with results. So now let's come now to the prayer, because we only have a few more minutes.
Sure.
Did you want to say something?
No, that's okay.
So that I don't cut you off.
Yeah, I could talk about it forever. So,
but I wanted to get to this because we only have a few more minutes. So now we're talking about, you know, let's talk about prayer. You founded the Connecticut House of Prayer.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, and you've led all kind of statewide prayers, regional-wide prayers.
Yeah.
I mean, I remember in, was it 2006? Where you had it at the convention center,
yeah,
you know, and you had the entire state literally there. So, I mean, you are a guru, if I can use that word, if you can permit me to use that word. Don't get too Christianese now, okay? So you are the guru, you're
sure
the expert, you know, and
mm-hmm
I mean that respectfully, in doing, leading kind of communal, kind of statewide prayer. So let's talk about prayer.
Sure.
Let's talk about why we preach about it, we talk about it, we read about it, but we don't do anything
mm-hmm
about it. And we only have 5 minutes left, by the way. And how we can also then bring the church together
uh-huh
to communal prayer. Because for me, the upper room experience is a communal thing.
Mm-hmm.
It's supposed to be a community thing of different parts of the
mm-hmm
body coming together.
Sure.
Because God will not move until he sees us
mm-hmm
united.
Yeah.
In one accord,
yeah,
right?
Right, yeah. I think that we're on the cusp of a great revival.
Yes.
As a matter of fact, I'm certain of it. And I think there's a lot of signs that we've been seeing
that
where that's been happening. And so
yes
we're pushing back against the gates of hell, you
yes
know? And that's why we feel pressure. And
yes
that's why I think we're feeling the pressure that there's not enough prayer going on. And
yes
so because we're pushing those gates back. But there is a lot, as I said earlier, there are a lot of prayers going on. But events like what you're doing with the upper room, if we could just backtrack, like say back to 1999 when we started the Connecticut House of Prayer,
yes
I didn't know anybody was praying around the state, you know, and
yes
I kind of set out on a quest to find out what was actually taking place. And then just before we had that big prayer meeting up at the state, at the Civic Center, I went around the state and did a DVD on what happens when churches pray. And I interviewed many, many, many pastors, and I got into people's faces and told them that they needed to pray.
Yes.
And pretty much people saw me as the prayer lady, to where when I started Generational Solutions, I had to make a big announcement and say, hey, don't refer to me as just the prayer lady. There's so much more to me than that. But that is the foundation of everything.
Yes, absolutely.
But communication is one of the biggest problems we have still to this day. Mm. We don't know what's going on. I was at an intercessory prayer meeting up in Massachusetts one day, and there was a woman who said to me, is anybody praying for Boston? And they had a united night of worship in Boston, and I think there were like 20,000 people who showed up.
Wow.
And I said, of course people are praying for Boston. She had no idea, because in the stream that she was in, it wasn't communicated.
Exactly.
It's not taught. It's not taught that we should be praying. So the church really needs to open up its eyes, and they really need to begin to promote prayer in the churches. They really need
to do it.
And do it.
Not just talking about it.
They need to do it.
And they need to engage the church body. I mean, I've noticed in some churches that they talk about it, they preach about it, but they don't engage the entire congregation in that activity of actually praying. And when they do, maybe it's like 1 minute or 2 minutes, just pray for your neighbor, you know, and that's it.
I think one of the problems we have in our church is that the people in the context of the church body have an expectation that when they go to church, they're going to receive something. We're supposed to go to church to worship God.
Yes.
We're not supposed to be going for what we can get out of it.
Yes.
We're going there to thank God, to worship Him, to adore Him, to bless God.
Yes.
But people are going so that they can get a word on Sunday morning.
We have to still bring it back to leaders. It's all this gospel commercialized, you know, feel good, what's in for me kind of gospel that we think is user-friendly and, you know, we want to use to draw people in. But the downside of that is that then people misunderstand
exactly.
the whole concept of what it means to be in relationship with God and what worship is, really.
Yeah.
And we don't have much time left. We only have 1 minute left. And it's just been great and an amazing conversation. I want to invite you to the upper room with me. It starts on Wednesday, July 3rd, and continues every Thursday because of the July 4th holiday. Continues every Thursday, I beg your pardon, until September 19th for 12 weeks. And the location is St. James's Church, 1018 Farmington Avenue, West Hartford, Connecticut. Meeting time is 9:30 a.m. in the morning until 11. And so I really hope that you'll be a part of the Upper Room experience so that your spiritual life shouldn't be on the back burner during the summer, you know? God should still be part of everything that you're doing. So join us every Thursday, you know, through the summer at St. James's Church on 1018 Farmington Avenue, and keep that spiritual life vibrant. Join us in prayer and seeking the face of God as we move through this season of transition to get us to destiny and revival. This is Princess Bola, the Total Success Coach, reminding you to keep smiling. You know, like I say, life's too short. Put a smile on your face. Keep networking, keep believing, keep learning. Keep on keeping on. I'll see you soon. Thank you so much for watching. Bye.